So this is exactly 8 p.m. here. We will start the proceedings of this session, starting with the welcome address. On behalf of the patrons of this school and series, Professor Viren K. Tiwari, the Director of IIT Kharagpur, and Shri Subir Chaudhary, Chairman and CEO, ASI Consulting Group, LLC USA, the advisory committee members of Subir Chaudhary Schools of Quality and Reliability, Chairman of this school, Professor A.K. Pradhan, a warm and heartiest welcome to our today's 15th distinguished speaker, Professor Moon, on this speaker series. We also welcome the participants from different domains of QRAMS, engineers, consultants, research scholars, and students who have joined this event. The topic of today's talk is a new approach to strategic thinking for economic development implications for India. We expect, like many other speakers who have spoken on this platform, the talks delivered by Professor Moon in this series will also fulfill the ideated objectives and expectation of the audiences. With these few words, we once again welcome you one and all and switch over to the next items of today's event by inviting my colleague, Professor Arun Rai, to read the speaker's biograph. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. And good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Professor Moon, a PhD from University of Washington, is Professor Emeritus and former Dean in the Graduate School of International Studies at Seoul National University. Professor Moon is currently Chair Professor of Seoul Business School at Assist University, Chairperson of the Institute for Policy and Strategy on National Competitiveness, IPSNC, in Korea, Overseas Professor at Beijing Normal University Business School, a consultant to United Nations Conference on Trade and Development, that is UNCTAD, and an honorary ambassador of foreign investment promotion for South Korea. He has been frequently invited to deliver lectures at several universities, including Stockholm University and Helsinki School of Economics, currently Aalto University in Europe, Kaijo University, and Beijing Normal University in Asia, and the State University of New York at Stony Brook and Stanford University in the United States. He has conducted many consulting research projects for multinational companies, for example, Samsung Electronics, international organizations, for example, UNCTAD, and governments, example, Korea, Malaysia, Dubai, Azerbaijan, Guangdong province of China, and India. For universities and debates, he has been invited by international newspapers and media, including New York Times, USA Today, NHK World TV, and Reuters. He has published numerous articles and books by top publishers, including The Strategy for Korea's Economic Success, 2016, Oxford University Press, The Art of Strategy, Sun Tzu, Michael Porter, and Beyond, 2018, Cambridge University Press, and Global Business Strategy, Asian Perspective, 2022, World Scientific Publishing Company. He has received the Academic Research Award by Seoul National University. Ladies and gentlemen, before I hand over the dais to our distinguished speaker, I would like to inform you that any question of yours has to be put in chat box. Commander Jaitley will act as Q&A moderator today, and he will exercise his rights on selecting the questions and putting up to our distinguished speaker. Thank you, Sir Professor Moon. The dais is now open for you to continue with your speech today.
Well, thank you very much for your nice introduction of me. And can I share my file now?
Sure.
Medium, this one, it works, I think. Okay, now can you see my file?
Yes, sir, we can see.
Okay, now I can start my presentation, right?
Right, sir.
Okay, well, thank you very much again for inviting me. And I think this is a very important opportunity for sharing my view with India. And as introduced in my profile, and I have had an experience of giving some consultations to several countries, including India. Some years ago, I was requested by the World Bank and to give us an advisory work for India. And at the time, I realized that India has a great potential, and so you can develop more. And as you know, Korea has experienced a lot of difficulties in economic development. And this is a very interesting case. So I have written some articles and books on Korea's economic development, and the view is different from those of the Western scholars. The Western scholars, from the States and Europe, they are pretty much smart and they are very much, scholarly, but they sometimes don't understand the wisdom and history of Asia. So if you listen to my presentation today, you can kind of combine the Western perspective an Asian perspective, so you can get kind of good implications for economic development of India. So my title of presentation today is a new approach. So this is to say it's a little different from the existing Western approach to strategic thinking. Strategic thinking is some people do not understand what strategy is about. Strategy is not just to find a kind of unique way of solving the problem, but my point is strategy is to find a minimum input for maximizing output. So strategy is kind of the most efficient way of doing your job. And this is for economic development. And again, I'm gonna say something for India. This is my profile, but it was nicely introduced, so let me skip it. So the table of contents is, so today's main point is implications for India, but example is South Korea. So South Korea's economic development, then we can find some interesting experiences from South Korea, and then we can apply them to India, that India is gonna be a lot more developed country in the future. So I'm not just talking about South Korea, but I will talk something about South Korea to get some idea for India. If you work on that, on the India, India has a really great potential. And then we'll get to conclusion. So number one, South Korea is, I'm from South Korea, but kind of educated and taught in the States and all over the world. And South Korea's economy is very unique and very interesting, not because I'm from South Korea, but South Korea is a good idea that how other developing countries can develop their economies. So let me just talk, along the three dimensions, economy and technology and the culture. As far as the economy is concerned, and South Korea joined the 30-50 club in 2018 with its significant economic success. The 30-50 club means, there is a club of countries which have 30 means $30,000 individual per capita income, annual income. So the country has to have at least $30,000 annual income. The 50 means 50 million people, and the country should have 50 million people. So the country has 30,000 economic annual income and 50 million people. There used to be only six countries in the world: USA, Japan, and four European countries: UK, France, Germany, and Italy. And South Korea just joined a few years ago that club. This is kind of, even South Koreans were surprised we could join that a richness club. So South Korea is actually the seventh strong largest economy in the world. And then, as you know, in the history of human being, developing countries remain developing countries. Developed countries are developed countries. But last year, July 2nd, 2021, the UNCTAD recognized South Korea from developing to developed country. So South Korea is the first country which was recognized by United Nations Trade and Development to be upgraded to a developed economy. So economic success. Technology-wise, South Korea was the seventh country to launch a satellite weighing more than 1 ton. And again, just last week, and they also launched a lunar spacecraft. And surprisingly, again, there's a Bloomberg Innovation Index, as you may know. That is like a Bloomberg Innovation Index. They list the most innovative countries in the world. Again, surprisingly, South Korea is listed number one. South Korea was number two last year, but this year is number one. So it is kind of surprising how South Korea in a short period of time could develop even technologies. As far as the culture is concerned, as you may know, there's a K-wave, a K-pop, a K-drama, and K-film. Now some derivatives of related industries, not just culture industry, but some other industries like cosmetics and even Korean food and Korean security. So there's a kind of a South Korean boom. And again, the point that I'm talking is not, I'm not bragging. I'm not just too much proud of South Korea. But I'm scholar, I'm professor, so you know, I'm not just Korean, but as a scholar, how can this country make this kind of significant success in the last like just 50 years or 60 years? When I was a little kid in Korea, Korea was one of the poorest countries in the world, really poorest, poorer than any of the African countries. So I still remember that Korea was so poor. But how come Korea has become so successful economy for the last 50 or 60 years? So it's kind of a very interesting case. And if we find those factors, then we can apply them to other countries, including India. So this is 30-50 club, like there are six: Japan, Germany, USA, UK, France, Italy, and Korea joint like this. The second one is, this is a Bloomberg Innovation Index. As you see here, Korea is ranked number one, followed by Singapore, Switzerland, Germany, Sweden, Denmark, Israel, Finland, Netherlands, Austria, and US is number 11, Japan and France, Belgium, Norway, China, Ireland, UK, Australia, blah, 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 like that one. So it is kind of strange. So we have to understand the secrets to success of South Korean economy. And this is Korean Wave in Hallyu. There's a BTS, and there's a Parasite, and you know, four Oscars and then categories, like the best pictures like that one. So my point is, you know, just a quick review of India. India's culture is good. There's a there's Hollywood in USA, but India, there's a Bollywood. You know, you have like a good dramas and films, and Indian films are pretty much kind of developed. So you have like a good cultural background, and also we have a historic cultural background. This is India is one of the four like a civilization sites in the human history. So culture, you have a great culture, and technology is good. Your technology is even better than South Korean technology, but your technologies are more like a space technologies and very advanced technologies. But Korean technologies are more commercial technologies, semiconductors and some others. And India has several Nobel Prize winners, but Korea has never so far, you know, won the Nobel Prize. So as far as culture is concerned, India is pretty good. As far as technology is concerned, particularly the basic technologies such as space technologies and kind of mathematics like that, and then Indians, nobody can beat the Indians. So culture is fine and technology is fine, even if those technologies are not that much commercialized, but it's still, you have great potential. But economy-wise, as far as the economy is concerned, you still have some problems. So you can fix the economy, then you will be okay with all the culture and then technology and the economy. I understand that most of the audience today are more like a scientist, engineers, and kind of in engineering department kind of. But if we add some economic perspective in terms of new strategic thinking, and that may help you to develop your economy and also help to fund your technological development. Okay, so again, get to my main point. The comparing South Korea and other developing countries. Look at this 1961 lower and left-hand part. Can you also see my cursor, the moving cursor? Can you see it?
Yes, we can see, sir.
Okay, you can see my cursor. Okay. Great. So if you look at like 1961, about 60 years ago, South Korea's per capita income, annual individual income was $94, lower than 100 bucks. And that was lower than Kenya. At the time, again, at the time, I was a very young kid, little kid in Korea, and it's so disastrous, so poor, you know. So in Korea, Korea was one of the bottom five, the poorest countries in the world. But now look at 2021 on the right-hand column, and Korea's individual income exceeded $30,000. It's $32,000, but Kenya is just $2,000, Argentina $9,000, and Saudi Arabia is $20,000. So Korea is richer than these economies. But my point is, some people say Korea's economic development was due to cheap labor. No, Kenya was cheaper in labor. And you need like a natural resources for economic development. No, Korea did not have any natural resource, but Argentina and Saudi Arabia have a lot of natural resources, but Korea is still doing better than Argentina and Saudi Arabia. So my point is, existing Western economics may not be right. For economic development, you need like a cheap labor or natural resources. No, and South Korea does not have any natural resources, and South Korean labor was not, it's not as cheap as Kenya, but Kenya was not doing very well. So my point is, let me get to the point because we don't have much time. So fundamental factors for South Korea's economic growth, and most of the other people, economists and some other scholars, particularly in the West, they think traditional approach, they may be South Korea may be cheap labor, or maybe export promotion strategy. Or maybe the chaebol and strong government, like dictatorship kind of things. And number four, maybe Confucianism. And I challenged this, and none of this is right. So my new approach is not cheap labor, but cheap and productive labor. What do you mean by productivity? The Korean labor at that time was faster than other people. You know, Korean labor was faster. They work faster. They do job faster. And they are pretty much more precise than their counterparts in Southeast Asia or Latin American countries. So not just export promotion, but global standard and economies of scale. While exporting, Koreans learn what's happening outside Korea. So they learn, they are very quick in learning. So they understand global standard. They know what's happening in the global standard, and they put a lot of investment and enjoy economies of scale. So they learn and then best practices. Chaebol and strong government is not just like the corrupted relationship between the government and business, but there is a good cooperation between public sector and then private sector. There's a good mix and there's a synergistic, like the government and private sectors, like 1970s and 80s, and the 60s and 70s, the founders of Samsung and Hyundai and LG, they were pretty much cooperative with the government of South Korea. There was a little corruption, but not that much. So more cooperative, more synergistic than just corrupted. In developing countries, there's always corruption, but more synergistic cooperation is more important than just corruption. And Confucianism is no good. There is a kind of desire for a better life. The Korean people are highly dedicated. This is a little different from Confucianism. I don't have time to explain this one, but it's not Confucianism, but desire for a better life. So they are highly dedicated to their job. They work very hard. They have like a strong goal. So they would like to go to good schools, like Seoul National University, very good schools. So this kind of thing is also happening in India and also in China. So it's not Confucianism, but it's a kind of desire for a better life. And they're highly dedicated, make a full dedication to their works because they'd like to make money. They'd like to get on the world. So diligence and goal. So pretty much different from traditional approach, and I challenged these four traditional factors, and I found these factors are really the real factors for economic development. Number one is agility. They are fast and precise. Number two is the benchmark. They learn quickly the best practices of the world, and they are good at converging seemingly different things. What do you mean by chaebol? Chaebol is a kind of integration of different businesses. They are very much good at converging seemingly different things. And then, not all Koreans, but some successful Koreans, they are very much dedicated make a full dedication to the work that they are doing. So the agility, benchmarking, convergence, and dedication are the four fundamental factors, not cheap labor, not expert promotion, and kind of things. So I named A, B, C, D's, A of agility and B of benchmarking, C of convergence, and D of dedication. So if these are the really fundamental factors for economic development, not very many people can easily copy these four factors. If the left-hand side, cheap labor and expert promotion, and these are the fundamental factors, anybody can copy it. So anybody can be a rich country or rich person. But if the success factors are on the right-hand side, agility and benchmarking, convergence and dedication, not everyone and not all the countries can do that. So you can probably apply these ABCDs to the social issues of India or economic issues of India, whether how agile your people are, how agile your country is, and how good at learning from the global standard, and how cooperative between public and private sectors, and how the people are dedicated, the labor force in India. Well, engineers and scientists, you guys are okay, but the general workforces, general workers are there, whether they are highly dedicated or not. So you can check the competitiveness, the strength of your workforce or your general people by these four standards. So this was published by the Oxford University Press and the reviewers of Oxford, and they like my challenge, and existing the traditional approach may not be right, and we may have to go with the new approach. So this was published by Oxford University Press. So this is the explanation of Korean economy and business by the ABCDs, but I also wrote some implications for other developing countries. Maybe the other developing countries may also have to learn or apply this ABCD concept rather than just cheap labor and cheap labor and cheap labor. And very recently, I have several other books, but very recently this year, just some months ago, World Scientific Publishing Companies, more global strategic issues. So, you know, the economic development of any country, including Korea and India and also any other countries, so you need like two things as far as the economy is concerned. Number one is some good strategic guidelines. What are the fundamental factors for success? And I think these are the ABCDs. You have to be agile, B, and C, and D. And then number two is you have to be globalized. You have to internationalize. So we have to understand like a global strategy rather than just domestic nationalism. Well, even if, you know, India is this big country, but if you are too much nationalistic, there's a kind of limitation for further development. So you have to enlarge the scope of a business, so internationalization. So two things that I'd like to emphasize all the time. Number one is like a strategic guideline, the ABCD, and then internationalization, so global business strategy. So let me like talk about, you know, implications for India. So implications for India is, I just chose some slides from my consulting work for India several years ago, like 2018, about 4 years ago, but I just selected a few slides. And now that in India, your current government, the most important policy of India is Make in India, okay? Make in India, not made in India, but you have to make the things in India currently to promote more FDI in manufacturing sector. And FDI means here foreign direct investment. So this is to say, for economic development in India, Indian people, Indian government realized that not just domestic business, not just domestic investment, but you need to attract foreign companies, foreign investment. We say foreign direct investment. You'd like to attract like a foreign investment, like Microsoft and Apple and Google, and then these guys, you have Samsung and Sony. So you'd like to attract these foreign companies into India and let them make things in India. And that will help Indian government or Indian economy. That's a good point. So internationalization, not just everything in India, but, you know, attract foreign investment in India. So not the service sector, because India used to be good at service sector. You know, Bollywood, the film making, that is a service sector mainly. And the software, India is just really good at software. So there's a good relationship between Silicon Valley and then Bangalore. So Silicon Valley, the other side of the globe, and then Bangalore. There's a good relationship between Silicon Valley in USA and Bangalore in India. Because India has a lot of capable and kind of reasonable priced software developers. So multinational firms would like to utilize Indian workforce. So that is fine. So internationalization is fine. But anyway, the point is, the Make in India is one of the main initiatives of Indian government to attract foreign direct investment. However, more fundamental factors need to be addressed for improving the business environment for attracting manufacturing FDI in India. This is to say, yes, now from Indian government perspective, you would like to attract foreign firms in India. So your specific policies are here that outlined in red, the red box, as I mark. So your strategy, the Indian strategy, is to promote the manufacturing of low cost, okay, eco-friendly and zero defect products. But now, do you think this is some years ago, like 4 or 5 years ago? But do you think that India is now here at this stage? No defect and low cost. Well, foster innovation, enhance skill development, protect intellectual property, build best in class manufacturing infrastructure. These are all good. Even if it is not easy to attain these goals, but these are good suggestions. However, these are not enough. Even if India is a low cost, foreign firms may not come into India. Even if you are very much innovative, foreign companies may not come to India. If you have highly skills, if you protect intellectual properties and manufacturing interests, you have all these. Even if it is not good to have all this, but even if you have this, they may not come to your country. Why? So interesting case is there's an economist, 2017, there's an economist, an article, the economist is published by UK, and make in India, it has loudly proclaimed that the country is open for business, organizing conferences and photo opportunities for Mr. Modi and foreign bosses, foreign CEOs. This signaling is no doubt useful. This is important. But little has been done for the last several years to tackle the shortcomings that discourage the foreign investors. So we have to understand what are the problems of India and other developing countries. Not just cheap labor and not just kind of things. So we have to understand what's wrong with some typical developing country. This is globalization. So we have to understand the global value chain means, let me take example of Samsung and Apple global value chain. The Samsung global value chain, Samsung Electronics, is leading firms are Samsung's, and there are affiliated and related firms. The leading firms are Samsung in Korea. Samsung, I have consulted Samsung Electronics a couple of times. And Samsung in Korea has good technologies. They have good R&D centers, research and development. And there is also the mother factory. So they control the operations around the world. For example, Samsung has the factory in China and factory in Vietnam. There's the largest factory in Vietnam. I have been there. To give some advisory comment to the Samsung operation overseas. And then, if there is any operation in Samsung Vietnam, if there's any defect, any problem, then instantly, within 1 second, and all the information is transferred to the mother factory in Korea. So they control the global operations. So this is like a headquarter of Samsung, so technology development and research and development and mother factory. But they also have Samsung in Silicon Valley, and they are trying to learn or develop more technologies in the center of the global technology center, that is Silicon Valley in California. They also have a design center in Milan, in Italy, and there are many sales forces in 50 different countries. So these are Samsung's works by the head work. But Samsung has many affiliated and related firms. SEV means Samsung Electronics in Vietnam, Samsung Vietnam, like an affiliation in Vietnam. So that's for manufacturing. They may manufacture most of their products in Samsung Vietnam. And then Samsung Corporation in Korea, Samsung Corporation, that is a little different section. They also provide flash memory and processor. And Qualcomm, this is an American company, they provide wireless communication. STN, Bosch, and Yamaha, they provide sensor. And Samsung and Intops and case, Samsung display, display and screen. And there are many other SMEs, small and medium-sized enterprises. Now let's take a look at Apple global value chain. There is a Silicon Valley-based company, American company. Technology and R&D and design are done in Silicon Valley, and they have sales forces for about like 16 countries. But they do manufacturing in China through American Taiwanese company named Foxconn. And they also buy processor from Samsung, okay, from their rival company, SAC Samsung. And they buy flash from Toyota, Qualcomm, American, STM, Bosch, HD, and LG display. They also buy display and screen from LG Korean firm. There are many other SMEs. So this is a global production site, and then they are cooperating with each other, okay, cooperation. But between the system, there is a competition like that. So the point is, no product is only made in one country. And all the parts and components are interrelated through global value chain. So what is the implication for this, particularly for India? You should not make everything in India, not made in India, but you know, you have to link some of your activities to the value chain of either Samsung value chain or Apple value chain. You cannot monopolize all the value chain activities. But you can kind of mix and link some of the activities into the global value chain. So the most important point for economic development is to induce, attract big international corporations into India. Then all the transactions and many things are going to be okay. So the key point is to attract foreign investment, like a multinational corporations into India. That's how and why Singapore has been successful. Singapore, they didn't have anything when they got independence in 1965. They didn't have money. They did not have technologies. So they attracted, the Prime Minister Lee Kuan Yew attracted foreign investment. Okay, and multinational corporations, big guys, they bring in money and technology and collaborate with Singapore people or its neighboring countries. So internationalization is not just the export. Many people misunderstand the real importance of internationalization. They just think when it comes to internationalization, you sell more to the foreign country. No, it's more investment, more global value chain, like cooperation, global value chain cooperation. So in order to attract foreign multinational firms, in order to induce like foreign companies to make in India, you have to do something else. Now, let me take a look at this. Key success factors for attracting investment in manufacturing in India. These are not again, cheap labor. They don't come just because of cheap labor. They don't, you know, and then you have to not better environment than people. You know, you can say that India was not good like 10 years ago, but nowadays it may be good. No, that does not persuade for investment. Not because of entire nation, not because of education. They may come to your country because of this. Not cheap labor, but productive labor. They are very fast. They move very fast. And they are very precise. They don't make much mistake. Not better than before, but better than competitors. Even if India is better than 10 years ago, but if India is still not as good as its competitors in other Southeast Asian countries or China, then they may not come to India. Even if India is better than before, but India has to be better than your competitors at this time. So it's not time series analysis, but it's cross-sectional analysis at the same time. So India, not just India, but all the developing countries, you know, they have to learn your competitors, and then you have to add something plus that then they would come to your country. It's not entire nation, but you need like a industry cluster, the kind of convergence of related industries and living environment. India is a so big country. You have like a 1.5 billion people. It's land-wise, it's very big. You cannot upgrade the entire nation in a short period of time. So why don't you concentrate on more efficient, like a clustering, more efficient region, so you can make it better than that region rather than the entire nation. The entire nation, it'll take time. That's why industry cluster or like a trade zone, free economic zone, is very much important. So you can still make it as efficient as possible compared to the entire nation. And education is not education, but for example, like the people working in other countries, Samsung in Vietnam or Apple in China, and they don't care how much educated the worker is there. They care like good working people. You don't have to understand like a calculus, differentiation, a high level of mathematics for the typical workers. But they have to have some desire for a better life. The workers have to understand that I have to make money. I have to feed my family. I have to be successful. That kind of motivation is not more important than an educated person. For the upper level, like people like you, then you have to be educated, engineers and scientists, but not typical workers. More work ethics is a lot more important than the level of education, the dedication, diligence, and motivation. So I slightly modified my ABCD model to like this, a little different, benchmarking convergence and these are a little different perspective, but still, variation or modification of ABCD model may work for attracting foreign investment. So let me just explain one by one, the agility benchmarking and convergence and dedication. I'm gonna show that like right-hand side, the four variables are more important than left-hand side. So number one, cheap labor, okay? Cheap labor, no, not cheap labor, productive labor. Look at this, the cheap labor. If you look at China and Vietnam, Apple, the Steve Jobs, Apple, after he made the iPhone and he invested in China. So if you look at the back of the Apple in the past, they say like designed by Apple in California and made in China. And then why Steve Jobs, the Apple company, chose China for manufacturing? Many people say because China is like labor is cheap. No, labor is not cheap. Look at this graph. China's labor was cheaper than Taiwan, Hong Kong, South Korea, and Japan, but China's labor was more expensive than all the other Southeast Asian countries. So if the cheap labor was the major concern, then Apple should have invested not in China, but in other Southeast Asian countries. And very recently, South Korean Samsung decided to invest in Vietnam because Apple invested in China. So Samsung invested in Vietnam. Why? Because people say, because Vietnamese labor is cheaper. No, Vietnamese labor, look at this, Vietnam. Vietnamese labor is more expensive than any of these, Bangladesh, Pakistan, and Cambodia, and Indonesia, and Philippines. So South Korean firm should have invested in Bangladesh and Pakistan rather than Vietnam, if they're just concerned about the labor. So Apple and Samsung's factories are located in the most expensive areas, within China and Vietnam. This is the expensive area, and this is very much expensive area. So it's not the labor cost, but it's more work ethics. It's more ABCDs. The second one is, again, competitor analysis. You may say that India is better than before, or Vietnam is better than before, and the current potential investors, they don't care whether they are doing better or not compared to the past, but they're just concerned whether they are better than their competitors at this time. So if we compare like India with other companies, India is actually not very good compared to other competitors. That's why the foreign companies are more interested in investing in other countries. So look at like India and China, our major competitor. So is this still, China is better. It's world ease of doing index. China is 78, India is 100. This is 110, this is 130, this is 3 and 8 and 18 and 45, 27th ranking and 40th ranking. So by any standard, and India is lower than China. So it's not cheap labor in some other sectors. But one point is, China, now, nowadays, many international corporations, multinational corporations are very much reluctant to invest in China because of many reasons, because of the tension between USA and China, and because like the Chinese government is so much authoritarianism, their Chinese government is too strong. The bargaining power of China government is very strong. So many multinational corporations are very much reluctant to invest more in China because, you know, China is too strong. So they're looking for alternative, and they have already looked for like Vietnam, and then they're looking for some other alternative countries, and India may be the right answer. I also argue, and I also say that in Korea and some others, you know, India may be the next like a very potential location for investment. So even the industry index, the confidence index, even if India has like a potential, it's number 8. Compared to other rankings, this is like 1 digit 8. Still, China is higher, but you know, you can still have a good potential. Overall, India is weak, particularly compared to China. However, India has a great potential as it is has high score in FDI confidence index. So many multinational corporations, many international firms are very much interested in India because they would like to transfer some of their facilities from China and some others to India. Even Apple now very recently has announced that they are considering transferring some of the facilities in China to India. So this is a really good time for Indian economy to attract foreign investment and globalize the Indian economy. The third one is industry cluster, you know, China and Vietnam. So you see, you know, cluster development can complement the disadvantages of rising labor and other costs. So this is to say, you know, once your economy is going up, your economy is doing very well, then instantly the labor cost will go up because your supply of labor is going to be limited with the increasing trend of economic development. So there's a labor cost up. So you have to move like one location to another because of the increased labor cost. But if you have a good clustering, then even if the labor cost becomes higher, you can still enjoy some other benefits, advantages. Well, let me take an example like of India. Now, I have been to India to give some consultations to the government of India four or 5 years ago. And then now there's a kind of statistic that Indian labor cost was lower than that of its competitors in Southeast Asian countries. But like the transportation cost, the freight cost is pretty much expensive. Well, at the time, maybe this may be changed today, but some years ago, India, the train transportation, the passenger transportation, this is good. The passenger fees are lower. But you know, the freight transportation, the commercial transportation, then that's expensive. So if you compare like a passenger transportation cost, India is lower, but commercial transportation, freight transportation, India was higher than its competitors in neighboring countries, 3 times and 4 times. And there are many other kind of problems in old road, and the road is so much crowded and so many people. So high transportation costs and high accident nationwide. But if you have like a good industrial complex, highly like a Bangalore, or even better, I have been to Bangalore, should be better than Bangalore. It's internationally, globally attractive competitive factors. Then even if the wage levels go up, because of the benefits of other convenience, because of the benefits of other things, then you can still maintain your competitiveness. That's why Silicon Valley is still there. The labor cost is very high, 10 times, 20 times. There's some clusters of Samsung and LG are there in Vietnam. They're very much expensive, but because of the cluster, there are a lot of benefits. So not nationwide development, but cluster development may be a key to the success for intermediary step for economic development. So now, like Apple and Samsung and LG, and they are creating their own industry zones by expanding the existing industrial clusters. So this is like a secret to success, the industry approach, not the entire nation. You cannot train, you cannot like upgrade the entire nation, but you can upgrade the small portion of the country that's a regional development or cluster development. So now the last one, ABCD, the D of ABCD, diligence and goal orientation. So this is interesting, not the educational level, but hardworking and attitudes of workforce are more important for attracting MNC. MNC means multinational corporations, manufacturing activities, particularly for countries hosting low value added. Look at this, the left hand side, the New York Times, 2012, and how the US lost out on iPhone work. You know, again, you know, the iPhone, this is iPhone, this is designed by Apple in California and made in China when they first introduced. Some years later, they changed it, not made in China, but assembled in China. But a few years ago, they just erased it because Donald Trump, the previous president of USA, Donald Trump, and he just pushed Apple to bring manufacturing facilities to USA. That's kind of reshoring strategy. So that, you know, why you hire people outside USA? You have to bring them back to USA. And when Steve Jobs was alive, he said, no, I'm not coming to USA. But Tim Cook, and he was not as strong as Steve Jobs, and he said he was kind of a little hesitating, and then he just erased that kind of message. So in the past, in the back of the iPhone, they said, yeah, you know, it was designed by Apple in California and assembled in China, but that there's nothing like that. But in some like iPad, there's a sign. But anyway, the American people, because Apple invested in China, and Apple hired like hundreds of thousands of people in China, but not Americans. So American society got a little mad. And the New York Times, and why? And how the US lost out on iPhone work. Why they invested in China, not in Korea, not in USA? And there's a New York Times an article, workers in China, a foreman immediately aroused 8,000 workers inside the company's dormitories. They resided in dormitories. Within 4 days, with a 12-4-hour shift, one plant was producing over 10,000 iPhones a day. And the New York Times said, the speed and flexibility is breathtaking, and no American factory, no American company, no American plant can match that. So there's nothing like that in America. You cannot match like the Chinese competitiveness in terms of speed and flexibility. No American company can make like 10,000 iPhones a day. And again, the workers in Vietnam, you know, the South Koreans invest in Vietnam and many others now. The Vietnam is booming. And why they invest in Vietnam? Foreign manufacturers used to worry about the skills shortage in Vietnam in the past. You know, Vietnamese people were not that much skillful. They were not that much skillful as Indonesians, and not to speak of India. India is more skillful. But Vietnamese, like 10, 20 years ago, was not that much skillful. However, the skills gap of Vietnamese workers is bridging every year. Vietnamese just learn quickly, benchmarking quickly. They are willing to learn. Vietnamese are willing to learn. They are trainable. They listen to the trainer and continuously upgrade it. Now they are very skillful. So it's not just the price of wage, not the labor cost, not the level of education, but this is like a motivation, diligence, and goal orientation. It's kind of the work ethic, the willing to learn. So the different cases. So we have to develop these things rather than just cheap labor and no defect and like innovation and R&Ds. These are fine. These are not, I'm not saying these are wrong, but more than that, on more ethics, work ethics. They have to be agile. They have to be willing to learn. They have to be able to combine different things, and they have to be motivated. I have to work. I have to be successful. And these are more important, and multinational managers are looking for these characteristics, not just cheap labor. Okay, now conclusion. So the conclusion is general directions for attracting investment in Korea, in India. So if the Indian, the policy implications is to invest, okay, not just by domestic company, but also attract like foreign investment. So again, let me conclude along the four ABCDs. Number A is you have to increase labor productivity, not just cheap labor, not just price, but productivity. Even if the price is high, but if you are more productive, that is fine. So not just cheap, but productive workforce. But what do you mean by productivity? They have to work faster than your competitors. And they have to reduce like a defect rate, like do works done. Just do it, no, just work well done. And then this is like a general implication for the labor workforce in India. But the government policy, the guideline for government policy is to reduce regulations. The any government, not just Indian government, you have to, as introduced myself, I am like honorary ambassador for foreign investment for South Korea. So I am kind of give this kind of presentations to the potential investors from abroad. And then I say in kind of similar stories like this, and the government should reduce regulations, not just India, but also Korea also has a lot of regulations and USA has a lot of regulations, but India may have more. So you have to reduce regulations, need to make the rules simple, so complicated. I know that it's very complicated. It takes forever. It takes a long time. It's a waste of time, waste of like all the efforts. And the process is like transparent. You know more than I do. So this is not just the labor cost, not just like a smartness, but this actually discourages the people to invest in India. This actually discourages the people like you, in doing business in India. So you have to reduce regulations to make it fast. Number two, compare India with its competitors, not 10 years ago, but currently at this moment, how competitive India compared to China and some other Southeast Asian countries. The main competitor of India is China. So you have to learn the best practices of your competitors and improve them. The currently India is good, but only in some. You are good at software. No, you are the best in Southeast Asian countries, West countries in the West, software and many services, all the call centers, all these go through the India, okay? All the call centers, and then we just talk to the call center people through the call centers in India. And motorcycles, you're number one. And satellites, and in Asia, you're number one, maybe compared to the China. So like spaceship technologies and all these are good, but need more in commercial manufacturing sectors. Convergence, develop related industries. So, not just industry itself, but infrastructure. The road condition is not very good. You know that. You know, a lot of like the Medicare's and hospitals and logistics is so crowded and it's so expensive and there are a lot of like accidents. So you have to solve this one. So there's much to be improved. And improve living environment in general. The multinational corporations, CEOs and managers would like to have a good living environment in the location that they would like. Well, you have to provide like good schools and good environment and hospitals like that. It's not just that particular industry, but related industries and also the living environment, not just industrial development. And it has to be much improved. The last one is dedication. Focus on economic goal. Many policies are formulated for political reasons. You know more than I am. Not just like a federal level politics, but also the regional levels. In the federal level, they said okay, but if you go down to regional level, the people say no, it's not okay. So there are a little confusion about the potential investors, and they may be discouraged. So many policies are formulated for political reasons, not just economic reasons. So you have to encourage some common goal. If it is economy, then let's just talk about the economy, not politics and not something else. So need to harmonize the interest of various stakeholders. I know that people have like different perspectives, on different situations, but in some sense, if we are talking about economic success, then let's just focus on economic success, not just something else. So these are kind of guidelines. I just summarized like a little complicated cases along the the four dimensions, A, B, C, D, some the general implications and some implications for Indian government. And, you know, again, you know, Korea has developed a lot, you know, very fast, but the secrets to the success are ABCDs, but those are not just unique to ABCDs, and those are also unique to some other countries, including in India. Some years ago, I have been invited by Stanford University, and I taught at Stanford University for 1 year, and I had a chance to do research on the competitiveness, the strength of the companies in Silicon Valley. And then I have also found, you know, their success is ABCDs. So my point is, you know, the ABCDs may be the core success factors, but your competitors may be different. You know, I talk to the Korean people, the ABCDs, and the Korean people say, no, that was good for developing stage, but now Korea is pretty much developed that we need a different model. No, the same model, but different competitors. In the past, 50 years ago, Korea was competing with some other developing countries. Now Korea is competing with developed countries, but still ABCDs. You have to be more agile than Japanese. You have to be more agile than Germans and French and Americans. So your rivals, your competitors are different, but the same logic may be the same. But anyway, you have your own wisdom and your own perspective, but if you add this kind of ABCD perspective, for economic development and attracting foreign investment, that may be helpful, I think. Well, let me finish at this moment. Thank you very much for listening. And if you have any questions and comments, please feel free to ask some questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Professor Moon.
Mm-hmm.
So nice of you.
Okay.
So can we start with the question answer session, please?
Sure.
Yeah. First of all, let me convey my congratulations to you and the South Korea for becoming a developed country now.
Thank you.
On 2nd July 2021, you have been declared as a developed country. So I think we must clap for South Korea because we have got a very good relationship with you.
Thank you.
And second, congratulations for coming first on the innovation index by Bloomberg. That's a great achievement. India also has been going up the ladder, but still we have reached at the 50th number as far as Bloomberg is concerned.
Okay.
And by some other agencies at 44. Mm-hmm. So we are going up the ladder, but still it's taking time, definitely. And we being a very big country, South Korea is a much smaller country, but still, we have our own plus points, we own minus points. One other question which I have received is, what are the measures India has to take for attracting integrated circuits, semiconductor manufacturing plants in India?
Mm-hmm.
Any suggestions you have? Because we don't make PC, ICs in our countries till now. We don't have any foundry.
Yeah, so again, you know, the semiconductor things, like nowadays, you know, the Taiwanese firms and Korean firms are good. And Taiwanese firms and Korean firms, you know, they would like to diversify their manufacturing. Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Okay. So the major producers of semiconductors, including Taiwanese firms and Korean firms, they would like to diversify their manufacturing because, you know, they don't want to put all the eggs in one basket. So now they are searching for like a good investment site. But frankly speaking, Taiwanese and Koreans are reluctant to invest in China because of the tension between China and Taiwan and potential tension between China and South Korea. So they would like to invest in USA, but USA is still a little too expensive. So India is a good location. So strategically, India has good potential. And then, you know, technologically, you know, people know that Indian workforce are pretty much good at mathematics and good at like the software engineers and all those things. So, you know, the potential is good. But the problem is maybe again ABCDs. The work ethics of Indian people, you know, I'm not, you know, insulting you, but we have to be honest. That if you show like a good work ethics, then they would they would come to India. India, they would like to come to India, okay? But because of work ethics, and I think people like you, yeah, you know, like you can appreciate that it's not just the price of labor, it's not the level of technology, but work ethics, good workers, okay, trustful.
So we welcome the semiconductor industry of South Korea to India.
Sure.
You can tell them, India will welcome them, I'm sure.
Oh, yeah. I will tell them.
Yeah.
Sure.
And we have very big presence of Samsung and LG in India. Okay. And they are doing extremely well in various factories. They are doing a very good job.
Sure.
And I also had some experience with the employees of Samsung in United Kingdom in 1986.
Okay.
We were classmates for the same training which was being given to us by a company at Brecknell software.
Mm-hmm.
So Samsung employees were there.
Mm-hmm.
And I was the commissioning crew of INS Virat. That time it was HMS Hermes.
Okay.
And just for your information, those days, and information of everybody who's listening, those days in the market, the suppose the same company product is available, assembled in Japan, it may cost £200. Exactly same product, 100% same. But assembled in South Korea will cost you, instead of £200, it may cost you £140. That much was the difference. It was assembled in South Korea.
Yes.
Because it was considered, you know, the cheap labor compared to Japan, and original kit is from Japan and blah, blah, blah. But today, I think South Korea has gone miles ahead compared to that time which I am talking about.
Exactly.
Okay.
Yes.
Here is another question. Somebody, Aniruddha Gautam, he says R&D and manufacturing, they go hand in hand. So how does South Korea synchronize with R&D and manufacturing?
Okay. Can you say again? Can't hear you very.
See, he says, Aniruddha Gautam, that R&D and manufacturing have to go together. Research and development and manufacturing both. So how does Korea make this synchronization? That you
R&D
and also in manufacturing both.
R&D and manufacturing?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Well, South Korean firms like Samsung and LG, have been trying to catch up with the big guys in the Silicon Valley. So, you know, some significant portion of their revenues from manufacturing, they always invest that in R&D. The chairman of Samsung and LG, they said, you know, in the past, you know, we worked on hardworking people, but the second stage is we have to do a lot of R&Ds, and now they are changing even that R&D perspective to design perspective. The next stage is you have to design like that. You know, for example, the competitiveness of Apple is, you know, Steve Jobs he's a designer. He's not actually the engineer. He was not educated like that. Even Elon Musk is a designer. And now Korean firms like Kia, Hyundai, and Samsung, they realize design is a lot more important. But so far, they have invested a lot for their R&D to catch up the state of the technologies of the main players in the major league. But they are slightly changing the characteristic of R&D from manufacturing oriented to design oriented. And then the new technologies such as an AI and things like that. And they are not directly related to manufacturing. But again, in the past, until some years ago, their R&D investments was very much consistent with their manufacturing capabilities, but now slightly changing to design and new emerging technologies.
Good.
Okay.
There is a question from Rajesh Patel. He says, how you see supply chain disruption can be circumvented in present world scenario? Probably, I think he has in mind the war between Ukraine and Russia, and the tension between Taiwan and China.
Okay.
If such things escalate, so how the supply chain disruption can be circumvented?
Okay, that's a good point. So in the international business in the past, like in USA, the labor costs were so high, so they would like to do investment abroad and manufacture abroad, but bring them back for final consumption in USA. That's what we used to call offshore manufacturing. And now, because of the coronavirus pandemic and supply chain disruptions, American people would like to bring those offshore productions back to USA. That's what they call reshoring. So from offshoring to reshoring. But to me, the most important implication of coronavirus pandemic and supply chain disruptions is not to bring your facilities back to your own country, but the idea is, implication is, do not put all the productions in one country, one location. Then that location may be in trouble. So many people expect that there will be less globalization because they are all reshoring back to their home countries, but I expect more globalization. You should not concentrate all the things in one because of the potential value chain, supply chain disruptions again. So there will be more like a diversification of those kind of things. So that's another good news. You know, even if China may be the best place or US may be the best place, but they would like to diversify. So again, India is going to be a good potential. You know, the semiconductors from Taiwan and Korea may be interested in diversifying, you know, from just China and, you know, like that.
Great.
Okay.
Another question is from Sandeep Mishra. According to him, Samsung contributes close to 20% of GDP of South Korea. And yeah. Hyundai, LG are also very big players.
Yes.
So he has a feeling that probably there is too much reliance on these manufacturing big giants.
Okay.
So don't you think South Korean government must act and ensure balance of power between various other industries also?
Well, that's a great question, and I've received several questions like that in my other presentations. You know, Korea is too much focused on the major chambers. Yeah, you're right. It's Samsung, like not 20%, but Samsung pays 20% of the corporate taxes to of the total GDP to the Korean government. So this is a big one. So what is the solution? There are two solutions. Number one solution is okay. Push Samsung to be smaller, like a smaller size. Make it smaller, okay? Make it like a reduce Samsung into one tenth of the size of Samsung. So it's a shrink the Korean economy. That's like option one. And option two is let other corporations in Korea, non-chaebol corporations, and let them benchmark Samsung and LG and other well-performing firms and increase their competitiveness. So why don't you make like a 10s or 20s or 30s of Samsung and LG kind of things? So option one and option two, even in Korea, there are two different perspectives. Some people say, Samsung is too big, too large to be controlled. So you wanna kill Samsung? Do you like to kill Samsung? Or let other companies follow the Samsung model? Or like, there's no direct competition between chaebol and small and medium-sized firms. As I show the global value chain, there's a collaboration between Samsung and other affiliated firms. So if Samsung is good and other small and medium-sized firms are also good, this is a global value chain. Samsung system is competing with Apple system, but Samsung system should be bigger and bigger and bigger. Now, people talk about like an antitrust law. We don't like a monopolizer. But you know, the monopolist is the monopolist may be monopolist in domestic business, but monopolist is still one of the competitors on global business. So we have to think about like a global level of competition rather than big guy in one country. So in that sense, we have to make a more Samsungs, not less Samsungs.
Okay. Now I'm just want to know. Do you have the problem of unemployment in South Korea?
On what?
Unemployment. Youth being unemployed.
I don't know.
Everybody has got a job.
On what?
Unemployment.
Unemployment. Okay, unemployment. Yeah. Well, you know, there are two different kinds of unemployment. One is like a voluntary unemployment. The other one is involuntary unemployment. In USA, now I'm in USA because my children are all live in America. They're all Americans and they get a job. You know, they have like very decent jobs. But in American situation is many people, the business is very good in America. So they just quit the job And then they just find another good job. Well, some people, you know, they quit the job and they take like 1 year off by traveling abroad. And they are preparing for startup jobs here in the States. So there are some portion who are preparing for their new career. And this is like a voluntary unemployment. But on the other hand, some other people are looking for jobs because they need jobs. This is a kind of compulsory unemployment. But here in the States, like a voluntary unemployment, this is like a transitory unemployment. It's kind of frictional unemployment. That is a little higher, so it is okay. In Korea is, again, like in between, Korea is not that bad. If you have some skills, you know, there's no problem for the people who get job. But in typical developing countries, including India, you know, there are a lot of like compulsory unemployment. I need a job, but there's no decent job for me, you know, to work for. So this is a kind of the economic development. But again, for policymakers, they have like two imperatives. One is economic growth or distribution of the wealth to the poor people. So we'd like to save some very poor people. But if you are just concerned about distribution of income, then you still have to grow the size of the pie. So you also have to think about like two rabbits, two birds. You have to find that, you know, that catch the two birds. One is growth and the other is distribution. So even if we hire some people, if they do not earn as much as they should, then there are a lot of problems, social problems. So economic growth and distribution, you know, this is kind of artistic view of strategy, and the government policymakers have to be very concerned about like the growth of the economy and also distribution to save the employment. But if you are too much populist, then you are saying more about distribution of income, like saying that for the poor people, but their portion should be very small. So you have to also be concerned about growth of the economy and then distribution of economy. Okay. Great.
Professor Moon, did you get the opportunity to visit India anytime?
India?
Yeah.
Not this time, but you know, sometime later, I would love to visit again.
Oh, you have never come to India?
No, I have been to India. I've been to India.
When was the last? Time.
Yeah, when was some years ago. I've been to India. There was a big conference of our discipline, Academy of International Business. That was some years ago, 4 or 5 years ago. No, a little more than. Academy of International Business. There's a big, like, American National Conference in India. Okay. So I presented some articles there. And then, as I told you, about 4 or 5 years ago, I was invited by World Bank and Korean government to give some consulting job for India. So I have been to there like 2 or 3 times.
Okay, may I suggest you to come to India at IIT Kharagpur and be a faculty here, visiting faculty for maybe 2 months or 3 months.
Okay, well, maybe, yes.
You will love it. Okay. And then you will understand India much more.
Sure, so we can talk more about
it. Go around.
Sure, yeah.
So we maybe invite you to IIT Kharagpur.
Okay, maybe a couple of months, maybe okay, but not the entire 1 or 2 years, but maybe a few months, maybe okay. I'm now retired from Seoul National University some years ago, but still I have been working for many different institutions. I have been invited by the Beijing Normal University in China and also some others. So I have some kind of like a short-term appointment, not like a long-term, because I'm kind of half retired. I still would like to work, so a few months may be okay.
Great. We would love to have you here.
Thank you very much.
Question from Satinder Barar. He says that now South Korea is a developed country, so maybe that they don't need ABCD model, which I don't agree. I think you still need ABCD model. And then he wants to know how probably South Korea and India can further collaborate, and South Korea can make use of the productive labor and the huge market of India.
Yes. Okay. That's good. You know, that's good point. And that's also a good question for the last question. But number one, I briefly mentioned the ABCD model was a good model for developing country, but even at the developed level, I think ABCD model is more important, because in the developed level, they have like a similar competencies, similar technologies, similar labor force. and similar whatever capabilities, then who's going to be the winner? The faster guy, more precise, learn more quickly, okay? And then the capability of integrating different kind of things. As I said, but your competitor is different. 50 years ago, Korea's competitors were Southeast Asian countries or Latin American countries. And now Korea's competitors are like European countries and America and Japan. But still, you know, you have to be faster than Japanese. You cannot be Japanese. No, I have been in Japan for 1 year for my sabbatical year some years ago, and they are very precise. They're, you know, Japanese are kind of very competitive, but they are not as fast as Koreans. One of the few things that Koreans can win the Japanese, Koreans like a pali-pali, is you say, you have to be faster than Japanese.
Yeah.
But you cannot only say that Koreans are more smarter than Japanese, Koreans are more intelligent. No, no, this, the Japanese are great guys. So, you know, the ABC, some of the ABCDs may work. So even at the developed level, you have to be faster than your competitor and blah, 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 blah. Number two, the collaboration between South Korea and India is great. The collaboration is when you have like a different characteristics, different factor endowments and different characteristics. But if you have like a similar goal, that is the best like a partnership for the different kind of things. So India and South Korea are located pretty much far, very, very different. But South Korea is diverting from American dependence to European dependence. And still Europe is not that much familiar to Korea, and then it's too expensive. So India may be a halfway to get into China. South Koreans are investing in some Eastern European countries, but India may be best. And also South Korea is very much interested in getting into Southeast Asian countries and Western and Asian countries. And India is definitely, in terms of whatever, is good. There's also a very historical interesting thing that some of the royal families of India, you know, came to South Korean peninsula like 1,000 years ago. There's a very interesting story, whether you know it or not. So anyway, historically, now we have like a different perspectives, but you know, there's kind of interesting case. And also you have some resources that South Korea do not have. And you have some like very reasonable skill forces, you know, the software engineers, and we know that. So there's our comparative advantages between South Korea and India are different. So there's a kind of very significant room for collaboration. So we work on that. So we can just communicate like through email or whatever, and then I will talk more about India when I talk with my Korean colleagues.
Thank you very much, Professor Moon. You can switch on your video and stop sharing before we come with the formal vote of thanks.
Oh, yeah.
And may I request all the attendees to just give a big hand.
Thank you very much. Moon. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you for inviting me. This is a great, great chance to talk with you. Okay.
Professor Sanjay, vote of thanks, please.
Mr. Rai, thank you. I would like to extend my heartfelt thanks to the guest of honor, Shri Sumit Chaudhary, Chairman and CEO SI Consulting Group, LLC USA, and Professor Virendra K. Tiwari, Director, IIT Kharagpur, for providing their valuable time and blessings. I would also like to thank Professor Retired Krishna B. Mishra, IIT Kharagpur, an internationally acclaimed academician and reliability guru and founder of erstwhile RAC, for showering his everlasting blessings, and Professor Moon for delivering today's talk as a distinguished speaker. I also extend my thanks to Commander Jaitley sir for being Q&A moderator, and all the participants who have contributed to make this event a grand success. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, Professor Moon, once again. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. We'll see you again. So now I can get out of this meeting. Okay, thank you. Thank you very much.